Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship. I will call your attention to the announcements that are printed in the bulletin. We remember with prayers and sympathy the family and friends of Don Sheldon. Don's funeral will be here tomorrow at 1:30. And we congratulate and extend our blessings to Catherine and Bailey Janiseski, who were married here yesterday. Everyone is invited to Saran on Thursday, November 3rd at 9 a.m. to put Christmas shoeboxes together. Treats will be provided. Also, having to do with the shoeboxes, it will cost $10 each to send them this year, and they will be delivered in mid-November. Donations will gratefully be accepted to help cover that cost. November 6th is All Saints Sunday, and on that day we remember those who have gone before us in the Christian faith. If you have a loved one that you would like remembered at that service, please call or email the church by noon on Wednesday. The Bible study group will meet on Tuesday, November 1st at 5 o'clock at the Rivers in Monty. If you'd like to see what that's all about, stop in, please. We, along with the Chippewa Valley Youth Club, are again collecting Christmas decorations. There have already been some dropped off here, which is great to see. Those will all be getting put together, and we'll be distributing them during the week of Thanksgiving. Thank you for your support of the church. Our offerings are down, so we ask that you please prayerfully consider contributing to help keep our church running smoothly. Baxter Welka will be collecting thank offerings on Sunday, November 6th. Are there any other announcements that should be brought forth this morning? Begin our worship this morning by responsively reading from Psalm 46. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth should change, though the mountains shake in the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble with its tumult. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High. God is in the midst of the city. It shall not be moved. God will help it when the morning dawns. The nations are in an uproar. The kingdoms totter. He utters his voice. The earth melts. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Come, behold the works of the Lord. See what desolations he has brought on the earth. He makes wars cease to the end of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the shields with fire. Be still and know that I am God. I am exalted among the nations. I am exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Our gathering hymn is number 504.
Thank you.
and who loves us beyond our days.
Amen.
Dear friends, together let us acknowledge our failure to love this world as Jesus does. God of mercy and forgiveness,
we confess that sin still has a hold on us. We have harmed your good creation. We have failed to do justice, love, kindness, and walk humbly with you. Turn us in a new direction. Show us the path that leads to life. Be our refuge and strength on the journey. Through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer and friend. Amen.
Beloved of God, your sins are forgiven and you are made whole. God points the way to new life in Christ, who meets us on the road. Journey now in God's abiding love through the power of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Hear the teaching of Christ. A new command I give you, that you love one another as I have loved you. The peace of Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
As God has given us peace through Christ, so let us pass the peace of Christ to each other. Please stand as you're comfortable and greet each other with signs of God's peace. Today have to do with Reformation. In the first text, which is one of my absolute favorites, Jeremiah speaks of the new covenant and how it's going to be lived out between God and God's people. The reading from Romans is one of the texts that changed Martin Luther's life and led to the Protestant Reformation. It calls for a turning away from works-based righteousness and legalism toward justification through grace.
Our first reading is from Jeremiah chapter 31, verses 31 through 34. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. It will not be like the covenant that I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, a covenant that they broke, though I was their husband, says the Lord. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law within them, and I will write it on their hearts. And I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No longer shall they teach one another, or say to each other, Know the Lord. For they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, says the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity, and remember their sin no more. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The second reading is from Romans chapter 3, verses 19 through 28. Now we know that whatever the law says, it speaks to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be silenced, and the whole world may be held accountable to God. For no human being will be justified in his sight by deeds prescribed by the law, For through the law comes the knowledge of sin. But now, apart from law, the righteousness of God has been disclosed and is attested by the law and the prophets. The righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. For there is no distinction, since all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. They are now justified by his grace as a gift, through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a sacrifice of atonement by his blood, effective through faith. He did this to show his righteousness, because in his divine forbearance he had passed over the sins previously committed. It was to prove at the present time that he himself is righteous, and that he justifies the one who has faith in Jesus. Then what becomes of boasting? It is excluded. By what law? By that of works? No, but by the law of faith. For we hold that a person is justified by faith apart from works prescribed by the law. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand as you're comfortable for the reading of the gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. John.
Glory to you, Lord.
Then Jesus said to the Jews who had believed in him, "If you continue in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free." They answered him, "We are descendants of Abraham and have never been slaves to anyone. What do you mean by saying you will be made free?" Jesus answered them, "Very truly I tell you, everyone who commits sin is a slave to sin. The slave does not have a permanent place in the household. The Son has a place there forever. So if the Son makes you free, you will be free indeed." The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated, and the children could come forward at this time. I think it's a good day to give someone a Bible because it's Reformation Day. And of course, you all have your Reformation Day stuff set up at home, right? For the party? Jeff, you got all your decorations up for Reformation Day? No? Did you notice that we have a different color in church than we usually have? Like what I'm wearing and what's on the altar? What color is that stuff usually? Yep. That's a good one. It's white sometimes. Yep.
Green.
It's usually green, but today it's red. What's it? Sometimes, yeah, one time a year it's black. That's right. It's red today, and it's red because of Reformation, and I would guess that most of you and most of us would have a hard time explaining what Reformation is, right? Does the word Reformation mean anything to you? It comes from the word form, and to form something is to give it shape. Have any of you ever seen when cement gets poured, like a cement pad or a sidewalk or anything? Have you ever seen that happen? Have you? What do you have to do before the cement truck comes to get ready? Yep.
you have to put up some boards, because if you just drop the cement on the ground, it's just going to look like a giant cow pie, only the wrong color. You won't be able to use it for anything. So you put up some boards, and those boards are called forms, so that the cement is the right shape, whatever shape you want it, whether it's round, like for a bin, or square for a sidewalk, or kind of triangular if you're going to put a tank or something on it. You need forms. And that's what form means. But maybe something you're more familiar with cement is Play-Doh. Have any of you ever heard of Play-Doh? Not the philosopher. Yeah, the stuff you play with, right? Yeah. Play-Doh is a good way to think about Reformation. What do you do with Play-Doh? Or what did you do with Play-Doh when you used to play with it? Yeah. You squish it. Yeah. What else do you do with Play-Doh? You can build stuff out of it, right? What else? Go ahead. You can cut it. Yeah, that's one thing that's kind of fun to do with it, isn't it? You pull a plastic knife and chop it up. Yeah. Yeah, you can. Oh, you can make your own? Yeah, you can. You can. When you take Play-Doh out, it's got that nice shape, right? And it's all the right color. I would say it smells good, but I don't like the smell anymore. I think it's changed since I was a kid. It smelled a lot better as a kid, but that's not surprising. Everything was better when I was a kid. But anyway, when you take that Play-Doh out, you can do anything with it, right? You can make it into anything. And when you get tired of whatever you make, what can you do? You can squish it some more, right? You just squish it again, and then you start over. You can roll it out, use cookie cutters. Yeah.
You can also make a snowman.
Yeah, you can make a snowman. Kind of the sad thing about Play-Doh is, yeah.
It doesn't last forever.
Yeah, it doesn't last forever. How come it doesn't last? Yeah. Yes, because most kids at some point, if they're playing with it, they leave it out. Or, yes, oh, you're waving back there, sorry. Or, if you've got two colors of Play-Doh, what ends up happening? Yeah. Yes, they get mixed together, and that usually ends up being brown. And there's only so much brown Play-Doh that's really that much fun. Or, like, you clean up, but some of the stuff is dry already, and you put that in with the regular stuff, but yeah. So, Play-Doh doesn't last forever. That's a good way of putting it. Well, Play-Doh has a lot to do with Reformation, because like that Play-Doh, each of us, yeah. Play-Doh is like us in a way that we all are made with everything we need inside of us. Everything that you need to live your life is already a part of you, as far as all the parts. God made you, God formed you as complete. Just like you don't have to add anything to Play-Doh before you play with it, right? And just like Play-Doh, you are all changing, right? Over time, things change. Not just your bodies, but how you think about things changes. And some things that you care about a lot now, you don't care about later, and all that kind of thing. But also, just like Play-Doh, once you get that brown Play-Doh, can you ever make it the color it used to be? No, no matter how hard you want to try, right? It's just brown. Once the Play-Doh is dried out, is there anything to do about it? I mean, maybe if you went on the internet, somebody on Pinterest can tell you how to fix it. But let's just pretend that's not the case and say once Play-Doh is dried out, it's dried out. And that's how we are, too. Sometimes different things called sin get into our lives. Yeah.
Sometimes when it's cold, you can get
a bloody
hand.
Yeah, that's right. Just like the Play-Doh, when things get mixed up, we can't fix it. But God can fix it. And that's how God works in Reformation. When we get to the point where our Play-Doh is so messed up and dried out that we can't do anything about it anymore, We ask God for help. Now, I'm not here telling you to break your Play-Doh. That would be silly, wouldn't it?
Dear God, please make my Play-Doh yellow instead of brown.
That would be a silly prayer. But we ask for ourselves, God, please take away the stuff that's mixed up in me that shouldn't be mixed up. Reform me. Make me into a better shape. Let's say a quick prayer, and then we'll go on. Lord, we thank you for forming us with your vision. We thank you for the opportunity to form one another, especially our children. And we are especially thankful that you are always able to reform us, to bring us closer to what we're meant to be. In your name we pray. Amen. Thank you, Nancy. You can go back to your seats. We talk about the kids not having a clear picture of Reformation. I'm guessing that's true of most of us. I doubt that many of us have spent a lot of time in Reformation preparation, right? And if we have a picture of what Reformation is about, it's probably some sort of fuzzy picture of Luther nailing something to a door somewhere and freeing us from the tyranny of Catholicism. I think Luther would be a bit upset at the idea that we call ourselves Lutherans, because it makes it sound like we worship him instead of worshiping the Lord. I doubt if he would be very comfortable with that. But be that as it may, this isn't about Luther anyway. It was never about Luther. It was about Christ working through Luther. So if we look at today as the anniversary of something that happened over 500 years ago, the details of which don't much matter, it's hardly worth the time it took to change the pyramids. They could just as well stay green and make the altar guild happier that they don't have to do all these quick changes that happen now. In the small catechism, we're not worshiping Luther, we can learn from him here. In the small catechism, Luther says that being baptized with water signifies that the old person in us, with all sins and evil desires, is to be drowned and die through daily sorrow for sin and through repentance. And on the other hand, that daily a new person is to come forth and rise up to live before God in righteousness and purity forever. That forever is a little bit confusing. If we're going to rise up in righteousness and purity forever, why do we have to do it all over again the next day? When I meet Luther, I'm going to ask him what he meant by that, or if it's just a poor translation from the German. But that idea that is at the core of our Lutheran faith is one that I don't think we give much attention. Daily we are, through examination and reflection, to repent and drown our sinful selves and be recreated. Baptism most certainly isn't a one and done. We can't say I've been baptized, now I'm good. My last quote from Luther here, but it's a good one. Luther is reputed to have said, "I tried to drown the old Adam in the waters of baptism, but that miserable wretch can swim." That's why we have to keep on doing it, because no matter how many times we push our selfish, sinful nature away, it's always ready to hop back to the surface. It's a process. Now, these red pyramids are to remind us of those who were martyred for their faith in Jesus and the gift of the Holy Spirit, and it sort of seems weird that we would think of the Holy Spirit in terms of red. At least it does to me. Generally, white seems like the right color of the Spirit, until we remember that we are baptized in the blood of the Lamb. That it's the blood of the Lamb that makes us clean. And that's what Jesus is saying in our gospel reading today. Jesus was the Word made flesh. That doesn't mean that God read the Old Testament and said, now I want to make a guy that shows what all that stuff was about.
And it doesn't mean that Jesus existed so that the rest of the Bible could be written, so that they had a template. It means that God was the Word. So when we reduce God back to words, when we proof text, when we use Scripture and hold it above what Jesus did and does, we're taking a step backward. It's not enough for us to learn about Jesus. And it's certainly not enough to say that we believe. That's how the text started today. Jesus was speaking to those who had believed. God came to the earth in the form of Jesus so that we could know Him. And that word know, that might be as slippery of a fish as the word love, really. What do we mean when we say we know someone? Being from a rural area, that comes up in so many conversations, doesn't it? Oh, you know such and such, don't you? Oh, you knew him. Oh, surely you know this person. All the time. And when we answer in the affirmative, sometimes it means, yeah, I know that person's name. Yeah, I know where they live. Yeah, I've heard stories about them. Yeah, I know a little bit about them. Sometimes it's just easier to say yes. Because if you're in the middle of a story and someone says, did you know Bob? And you say no, then you get 20 minutes on who Bob was and where he lived and what his address was and what color socks he wore and all this extra stuff. So you say, yeah, I know him. Go on. How many people do we really know? I did a wedding here yesterday. If you ask if I know Bailey and Catherine, of course I'll say, yes, I did their wedding. But do I know them? They took a little computer test and we talked to each other for 9 hours. That's more than I've done with a lot of people. So yeah, I know them a bit. I know a lot of people a little bit, right? I know them based on how I interact with them. But that doesn't mean I know them. The only way to truly know someone is to spend time with them. Even as I prepare for tomorrow, I would say that I knew Don better than I know a lot of people. But there is so much about him I didn't know. Believe it or not, we didn't sit and have a lot of deep conversations about how we felt, about what the meaning of life was. I would guess most of the rest of you had those conversations with them, but I didn't. We mostly talked about sheep and road ditch hay and that kind of thing, right? We know, really know, very few people. So when we think about the question, do we know Jesus? If we say yes, what do we mean? It's the same range, really. Yeah, I know Jesus. I went to Sunday school. Yeah, I know Jesus. I go to church. I read the book. I can quote you some scripture. But it's the same way that the only way to truly know Jesus is to spend time with Jesus. And as the text says, Jesus is the truth. And I would say part of the reason that we don't know Jesus better is, as Jack Nicholson once said, we can't handle the truth. It makes us uncomfortable to hear the truth. And Jesus only gives us two options. Option one, we live in Him. Option two, we live in sin. And I don't mean the kind of living in sin that some racy, bright lights lifestyle, or that ends up with us laying in a gutter, clutching a bottle in a brown paper bag. What I mean by living in sin, and what I believe Jesus means by living in sin, is that we live according to our impulses, what's easiest at the time, what feels better. We just go along. And some of that is necessary, isn't it? There isn't always time to stop and reflect. Life happens fast. Things happen fast. So we go up and down in our faith. C.S. Lewis called it the law of undulation. And that might be not mean much to you, but I love words, and I love that word undulation, the waves of our life, right? We ride up, we go down. It's the way our lives look. So, we either live according to our impulses, or we live a life directed by our growing relationship with Jesus. And please don't confuse this with following the rules. That's not what it is about, of having this checklist and running it through our head. Sin or not a sin, do or don't do, especially when we direct that outward. That is not freedom. Freedom to point out the sins of others is not what Jesus is talking about. The truth will make us free, so it is freedom. In some cases, like with an engine, being free is the opposite of being stuck, right? I remember on my dad's auction, I had an old Indian dirt bike. And a guy went up and he got beside it and he tried to kick it over and it didn't kick over. So when it went to sell, the guy said, "It's stuck!" And he bought it for like $12. It sat on the south side of Granite for years. And every time I drove by it, it bugged me because the minute the auction was over, he kicked that motorcycle over. I think he was faking. But stuck is worthless, right? That thing was a paperweight. Free, it does what it's supposed to do. A bird is free when it can fly, when it can spread its wings and fly. And that's what it means for us to be free. Christ created us for a purpose. And when we're free, we're able to live into that purpose. We're able to be who we're supposed to be and live the way that we are supposed to live. Amen.
Thank you.
As we celebrate the Reformation, let us also pray for reconciliation within the body of Christ. For the church that in every age has taught the faith to children, shared the sacraments, and fed the poor. O God, we give you thanks. For the times when the church has let the human urge for power and self-preservation prevail over the will of God. O God, we ask forgiveness. For those who work to create unity among all the churches and seek to find ways to walk together. O God, we give you thanks. For us, when we promote doctrine over our oneness as children of God and brothers and sisters in Christ. O God, we ask forgiveness. For those in every age who bring reformation and renewal to the church when it has become complacent, we give you thanks. For those instances when we have driven off those who had a different vision of God's will for us, O God, we ask forgiveness. For the diversity of expression in our many churches and denominations, and for the spirit of liberation that allows the church to continually renew itself. O God, we give you thanks. For the church, that we may be worthy and willing to work at healing divisions among all worshiping communities throughout the whole world. We pray in the name of God, who is creator of all. Amen. And we pray together the prayer that you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated as the offering is received. Bless you with truth and peace, and may the Holy one God, guide you always in faith, hope, and love. Amen.
Thank you.
Well, if you know, it's the non-member wedding fee, and I don't remember how much that is. I do not, but I mean that's the essentially what it's for. Yeah. So, yeah. But